Yes, she looked like that. And her father's lovers were very, very elegant women. And they had a major effect on Catherine Webber's childhood. And of course, she grew up to be, you know, one of the top writers in the country, I think.
Yeah.
But was very, very much affected by these women.
Well, you have to be, I mean, that's the part that breaks your heart, because she sees the mother sitting home alone.
Yes.
And she sees gorgeous, attractive daddy in his English clothes.
Yes.
And the other thing is, film producer besides.
Yes, and she never knows, they never know when he's coming home, if he's coming home for dinner or if he's not going to be home for 3 or 4 months.
Yeah.
They never knew. He never felt accountable to them for his life. So it was very difficult.
Yes. Then there's the other Webber.
Nancy Webber.
Nancy Webber's story.
Yes. Nancy writes really about the responsibility that the other woman has to the wife. That the other woman should always send the husband home in at least as good a shape as she got him. And always keeping in mind that it's the wife who's home watching the children, washing his clothes, and taking care of his needs, and therefore she should always be held up in esteem.
Yeah. Well, that's sort of a polygamous feeling there.
Yes.
Yeah. How did you get these women, and I'll just list some of them, Jane Smiley, Lynn Freed, Susan Cheever, quite a story she tells.
Yes.
Diana Abu-Jabir, Pam Houston, to open their hearts, because this is all, as one of them quotes, Warner Books says, has to be the truth, has to be nonfiction.
That's right. And they all had to sign contracts that what they were going to write was going to be absolutely true. It wasn't so difficult, because when I had the idea of The Other Woman and having an anthology, I was first sort of held back by the thought that, well, none of these authors are going to want to tell these stories.
Yeah.
They're so intimate. But not only did they want to tell the stories, they couldn't wait to tell them. In fact, Jane said, we were just waiting for her to contact us, and you would have thought so, because the stories that came out of them were amazing. And somebody said to me, so did you ask them, were they the mistress, were they the wife? I said, no. I asked them, did you have this experience on either side, and if so, would you write about it? And it turned out that, coincidentally, the book became quite balanced.
Yeah.
And what they told was, well, no holds barred. I mean, the honesty.
Well, the honest story is Eustace. Her first name is Mary.
Mary Jo Eustace.
Who happens to be the wife in the Tory Spelling Dean Eustace story.
Dean McDermott, actually, but we call him Mr. Eustace, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, she gave up an enormous career in Canada as a television talk show host, and moved to L.A. so he could pursue his career in the States. And he did a movie with Tori Spelling, and 3 weeks later, he told his wife that he was leaving her, 3 weeks after they had adopted a baby.
That killed me. Here they have adopted this child.
Absolutely.
And in some places, they could lose a child they had adopted with something like that going on.
There was actually a problem when she went back to Canada. And I'm not sure about the legalities, but I did read an article that there was a question of whether or not she could keep the child, because now she was a single parent. There were attorneys involved, because the original birth mother or father wanted the baby back. I mean, it was really a nightmare that she was put through.
Then,
and she wrote a beautiful
then
essay.
Then there's who Ellen
Sussman wrote, Invite the Bitch to Dinner.
Yeah.
Where her husband is a young attorney, and he has a summer intern working in the law firm, and he admits to Ellen, who admits to him that she's had a crush on somebody, that he's had a crush on this woman, Nancy, and she says, well, invite the bitch to dinner, and they just are oil and water.
Yeah.
Years later,
she
marries a second time, and her husband says, oh, you know, when I was a young attorney, I had this dear, dear friend in law school, you will love her, and who shows up? The same woman.
Love that. And then you can have the other woman in other relationships, too, that you have in this book.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's why we call it Wives, Lovers, and Others. Maxine Rhea Leighton writes about becoming the other woman at the age of 6 when she begins to be abused by her uncle, and how she grows and how it affects her relationships with men.
Yeah.
And it's been quite an extraordinary experience for her.
Yeah.
Writing about it for the first time, standing up in bookstores and doing her readings, and feeling the support of yeah. absolute strangers. It's been very empowering for her.
It's an extraordinary book, Victoria.
Thank you.
And everybody will find something in this book they will know of or identify with. I thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Will you autograph my book?
It's my pleasure.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, email me at talksbooks@lycos.com or look us up on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com. Read our column in the Beverly Hills Courier. We'll tell you about some other books. Support your local library. Go in, take out a card. As I said, you can go right back to Abraham and Sarah for the first other woman. But another great French writer, Colette, she had a way of writing about the other woman as well as being with the other woman at times. So support your local library, take out a card, go. Authors are reading there all the time, and you'll enjoy what you're reading. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.